We've considered the bioenergetics of closed systems and arrived at the equation delta H equals delta G0 plus T delta S. In this module, we'll apply this equation to see how delta H, or enthalpy change, and delta G0, the free energy change, or standard free energy change, can be determined for chemical reactions. And we'll extend our understanding of thermodynamics from closed systems to open systems. We can measure the enthalpy change, or delta H, in a bomb calorimeter, like the one cartooned on this slide. As the reaction proceeds, the change in temperature in the calorimeter will be detected as a change in the temperature in the water in the outer jacket. If the jacket contains, for example, 100 milliliters of water, and the temperature rises by 5 degrees by the time the reaction reaches equilibrium, then the reaction must have generated 500 calories. Remember that a calorie is defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 milliliter of water by 1 degree Celsius. Okay, here are two examples. If you burn 0.18 grams of glucose in a calorimeter, the temperature of that 100 mils of water would rise by 6.73 degrees Celsius. That would mean that the reaction yielded 673 calories, or 6.73 times the 100 mils of water in the jacket. If you had burned 1,000 times as much glucose, or a mole of glucose, 180 grams of it, it would have generated 673,000 calories, or 673 kilocalories. Okay, that means the enthalpy change, or delta H, is equal to minus 673 kilocalories per mole of combusted glucose. A reaction that liberates heat is defined as exothermic, and the delta H of an exothermic reaction is going to be negative. Now, you should recognize this chemical equation as the one for respiration. Now, the second example describes photosynthesis, the exact opposite of respiration. It should be no surprise that the enthalpy change, or delta H, for this reaction is plus 673 kilocalories per mole of glucose made. A reaction that absorbs heat will have then a positive delta H and is by definition endothermic. So, we can measure the enthalpy change, or delta H, directly using the calorimeter. We can determine the standard free energy change, or delta G0, indirectly by knowing the equilibrium concentrations of reactants and products in a chemical reaction and using the Boltzman equation shown here, where R is the gas constant and T is the standard temperature and the KEQ is the equilibrium constant for the reaction. You can see that the gas constant is 1.987 calories per mole degree, and you may remember that the temperature, the standard temperature, is 298 degrees Kelvin, or 25 degrees Celsius. Let's talk about getting the equilibrium constant. Here's how you do it. Assume the generic reaction shown here. When that reaction is over, that is to say when it reaches equilibrium, we would assay the concentrations of the reactants and or the products. The equilibrium constant for this reaction, the KEQ, is the product of the concentrations of the products divided by the product of the concentrations of the reactants, as shown in the equation. More accurately, the concentrations would have to be raised to a power determined by the stoichiometry of the reaction, as in the second generic example shown here, in which A plus 2B goes to C plus 2D. Then the K equilibrium, or the equilibrium constant, is equal to the concentration of C times the concentration of D squared, divided by the concentration of A times the concentration of B squared. Consider this hypothetical reaction. A plus B goes to C plus D. After measuring the concentration of reactants and products at equilibrium, we would calculate the equilibrium constant, the KEQ, and show it to be 4.5 in this example. I can tell you immediately that this reaction is exergonic. So how do I know? From the Boltzmann equation. If the K equilibrium, the equilibrium constant, is greater than 1, then the natural log of the equilibrium constant will be greater than 0, making delta G0 negative. If the equilibrium constant is positive, it means that the product of the concentrations of the products is larger than that of the reactants. In other words, at equilibrium, the overall concentration of products is going to be higher than the concentration of reactants. By definition, then, the expression minus R times T times the natural log of the equilibrium constant from the Boltzmann equation will be negative. Go ahead and check that out for yourself. We say that such a reaction favors products because the concentration of the products is generally higher than that of the reactants, and we say, therefore, that the reaction is energetically favorable under standard conditions. Such a reaction is defined as exergonic. And note the unequal equilibrium arrows in this reaction that are telling you the same thing. The long arrow is pointing to the products, meaning there will be more product at equilibrium than reactant. By the same token, the reverse reaction, written this way, C plus D going to A plus B, must be, we say, endergonic, or energetically unfavorable in a closed system under standard conditions. Here, the equilibrium constant for an endergonic reaction will, by definition, be less than 1. Figure that out by looking at the Boltzmann equation. The log, or natural log, of a number less than 1 will be negative, so that minus R times T times the natural log of KEQ, or the natural log of the equilibrium constant, a negative number, will be positive. Okay, to sum up, the change in enthalpy, or delta H, is a measurable quantity using a calorimeter, and the standard free energy change, or delta G0, is a calculable number using equilibrium constants and plugging it in to the Boltzmann equation. Now, knowing delta H and delta G0, it's a simple matter to calculate the entropy change for the reaction. Here are two familiar examples. Here's respiration again. The enthalpy change, we said, was minus 673 kilocalories per mole of glucose burned, and the standard free energy change, or delta G0, works out to minus 686 kilocalories per mole of glucose burned if you actually measured the concentrations of CO2, oxygen, glucose, and water at the end of the reaction at equilibrium. And when you solve the equation delta H equals delta G0 plus T delta S, for delta S turns out to be plus 43.6 kilocalories per mole degree. As you may recall from math classes, the units of your values are very important. So note the units of entropy here are kilocalories per mole degree, and reflect that entropy is in fact temperature dependent. In this equation, in solving for delta S, we use 298 degrees Kelvin as the standard temperature. Here's photosynthesis again. Delta H here is plus 673 kilocalories per mole of glucose burned. The standard free energy, delta G0, is plus 686 kilocalories per mole of glucose synthesized. And you don't really have to do any calculations at this point, but T delta S can be solved, or as I say, intuited, to be 43.6 kilocalories per mole degree. Now, it looks like photosynthesis is occurring with a decrease in entropy, right? A negative 43.6 kilocalories per mole degree. How's that possible? You can arrive at the answer in two ways. First of all, consider the relationship between delta H, delta G0, and T delta S described by the equation delta H equals delta G0 plus T delta S. For this equation to be valid, in fact, for any equation to be valid, each variable is assumed to be determined by the value of the others, and any one of them can be therefore either positive or negative. That answers the question, how can this be? Because S, or entropy, could also be either positive or negative, or delta S could be positive or negative. But why isn't this a violation of the third law of thermodynamics that says entropy in the universe is always increasing? That's because this equation is for reactions in what we call a closed system under standard conditions. Universal entropy is indeed always increasing, but the entropy of a closed system can in fact decrease. In other words, order can increase within a closed or isolated system. This can happen provided that entropy will increase elsewhere in the universe as a consequence of creating a bit of order in a small corner of the universe. Of course, this explanation begs the question, if there are closed systems, then what's an open system? maybe the first thing to realize is that a closed system is, it's not really closed. In fact, there's really no such thing as a truly closed system. What we call a closed system is really an isolated system. I used the term isolated system a moment ago. What that means is we can isolate a system like a chemical reaction, and that just means we can set up conditions so that we can actually measure enthalpy change and standard free energy change from the concentrations of the reaction of the reaction participants at equilibrium. But the universe really consists of open systems that exchange energy and mass between them. So if our equation delta H equals delta G0 plus T delta S applies only to closed systems and then only under standard conditions, can we in fact measure energy changes in open systems? First thing we need to do is talk about the property of open systems. As I said a second ago, open systems can exchange energy and mass with their surroundings, whereas closed systems can't do that by definition. Open systems, because they can exchange mass and energy with their environment, never really reach equilibrium. They never reach equilibrium. What an open system will do instead is achieve a steady state. And a steady state is one in which the rate of input of reactants and energy is equal to the rate of output of energy and mass. Another feature or property of open systems is that the steady state can change. Just imagine that there is a depletion of reactants, and then there's not enough reactant to put into the reaction, and the steady state is going to, in fact, slow down or change. Another property of open systems is that steady states are not constant. They can change. The result of the ability of steady states to fluctuate, to change, is that an energetically unfavorable reaction in a closed system, that is an endergonic reaction, might actually be energetically favorable, or we would say spontaneous, in an open system. And we're going to see some examples of this when we look at the actual free energy change in open systems. So for open systems, we can measure energetics. For open systems, we will measure the actual free energy change, or delta G prime, the change in actual free energy. Delta G prime, the change in actual free energy, and delta G zero, the standard free energy change in a closed system, are related by the following equation. Delta G prime equals delta G zero plus RT times the natural log of this expression. The concentration of C in the steady state times the concentration of D in the steady state, those are the products of a reaction, divided by the concentration of A in the steady state times the concentration of B in the steady state. A and B, of course, are the reactants in our generic reaction. So the SS stands for steady state here. That brings us to the end of this presentation. Later we're going to have a chance to look at actual free energy changes when we look at glycolysis.